Welcome back, everyone. This is video two for chapter six on weathering in soils. Today I want to start with discussing what influences how quickly something weathers. And one of the criteria that determines how quickly a rock weathers is its mineralogy. What are the characteristics of the rock itself? According to Bowen's reaction series, it happens that silicate minerals weather in the same order as crystallization. Another example, carbonates and halides, like rock salt, would weather more quickly than silicates. Another factor influencing how quickly a rock will weather is what climate the rock is in. The general rule of thumb is more moisture and warm conditions, the faster rock will weather. Temperature extremes as well determine how quickly the rock will weather. If you are in a climate where there is a lot of freezing and thawing, that tends to mechanically break down the rock quite quickly. Granite, because it has so much quartz in it, which is stable at the Earth's surface, tends not to weather as quickly as a calcite-rich monument, in this case, marble. This is another image showing chemical weathering due to the rock type. When we talk about differential weathering, that refers to the preferential weathering of one rock formation over another. That depends upon the climate as well as what the composition of the rock is. This shows a nice example. Let's talk about soil. By definition, I need you to know that soil is a combination of mineral and organic matter, water, and air, and is able to support plant growth. Soil scientists use the term soil texture to refer to the proportions of different particle sizes. That is important because the proportion of particle sizes influences the soil's ability to transmit and/or retain water and air. Four basic soil structures are recognized. They are called platy, prismatic, blocky, and spheroidal. There are various soil classification systems. This diagram is the United States Department of Agriculture soil classification system. This figure is called a ternary diagram, and you plot the percentages of clay, silt, and sand on these ternary diagrams, and where they intersect will tell you the type of soil you have. Looking at point A, let's start with our percent clay. Clay is going up these red lines by tens. So you can see at point A, there would be 40% clay. As far as silt, 100% silt is this point right here. Zero is this line. So we're going to follow the green lines to plot our silt. So it only goes to this first line here, which is 10% silt. So we have 40% clay, 10% silt, and then finally sand, we can plot 100% sand at this point here, and we're going from this line toward the 100%. So this is 10%, 20%, 30, 40, 50. So it looks like if we go up here, 50% sand. So with 50% sand, 40% clay, and 10% silt, we would call the soil a sandy clay. That's how you plot on a ternary diagram. This figure shows some of the controls of soil formation. If you have a steep cliff, soil tends not to form because there are no plants to hold it in place, and gravity simply washes it down. In this floodplain region, soil tends to accumulate in thick deposits. In a gently undulating topography, you can also develop thicker soils. If the soil is sitting directly on top of bedrock from which it formed, we call it a residual soil. If the soil is on top of unconsolidated deposits, such as those on a floodplain, we call them transported soils. So the most influential factor of soil formation is the climate. Key factors: warm temperatures, lots of rain equals faster mechanical and chemical weathering. Plants and animal activity also influence the formation of soil. And time. We need to consider soil as a non-renewable resource. It simply does not renew itself in a human's lifetime. So the general rule is the longer the time, the thicker the soils. Looking at different areas and soil formation, we can start out in a northern coniferous forest, and due to the type of tree, there is a high acid content which accumulates in the soil and helps break down material more quickly, and so adds to the soil forming process. Very little soils accumulate in the desert. There simply isn't enough water. Therefore, there's very little vegetation. An excellent location for soil formation would be in a well-drained prairie area where you have humus-rich surface materials, and fertility of this type of soil is excellent. I mentioned topography a couple slides back as far as the control of soil formation, and steep slopes, once again, because of gravity, tend not to have very well developed soils, whereas flat and undulating surfaces are better for soil formation. Soil forming processes operate from the surface downward, and we can divide the layers into what we call horizons. A vertical section through all of the horizons we're going to call a soil profile. This is an idealized soil profile. Starting at the top, we have the O horizon, O for organics. It is a dark layer because of the presence of organics. Below the O horizon is the A horizon. Here we have mineral matter with some organics, what we call humus. Below the A horizon is the E horizon. This is the zone where material gets dissolved or the physical particles get removed and taken down to the zone of accumulation called the B horizon. The C horizon is partially altered parent material, and here is the unweathered parent material. A summary of the horizons. Take a moment to look through. Here's an example of a soil profile where the horizons are indistinct. You really can't see a difference. Whereas this profile shows definite, well-developed horizons. This ends our second video for Chapter 6.